This week on Making an Anime, let's set up our geometry line art in Blender and finish any last scene animation that we might need. There's many ways to tackle generating 2D line art from geometry in Blender. From shaders to grease pencil, I played with a few options and tools and ended up using the Line Art Curve Modifier, which is an amazing add-on on the Blender market with a great developer. Everything we're about to do in this episode with this add-on is possible natively to Blender, but as always, with just a few more clicks and workarounds here and there. If you get this add-on, you basically get this default scene that you can save anywhere in your directory. Then in Blender, click on Append and go into the scene's object folder and add this append file. I set up my Blender file to always start with a default point light and render cam in their own default collection. This is where I keep the appended line art object. I like to rename the first line art object as default 01. For anything you want to apply the line art on, they need to be in their own collection, separate from the line art object. The line art object has a geometry nodes modifier. Under its scene option, add the collection that you placed your objects under and where you want your line art applied. Now, under camera POV, select your render cam. And bingo, we have line art from our camera view. But it's looking a bit tessellated or blocky. We're seeing too much of the wireframe. The key now is playing between the subdivision level of the target object and the line art object settings interchangeably. The higher subdivision has created smoother lines, but at the cost of not reading or seeing as many contours. I like to set the resample detail level to 5 for better results. Anything above 5 tends not to impact the scene greatly. Check silhouette if you want the outline of the object always present. I'm applying an emission shader, which is white, or the background color, just to read the line art in isolation. As we increase the crease angle threshold value, we read more of the object contours, i.e. the shape of the eyes and the mouth details. However, at higher values, we also pick up more lines from the higher density edges, making it look blocky and like a wireframe. We counterbalance this with increasing the geometry resolution. As the geometry resolution increases, the distribution of edges become more even, so we see less of the wireframe effect in the line art. Just remember, the higher the resolution, the slower your render or scene will be. Once you're happy with the values, you can keep your scene resolution to 0 and have the desired resolution only at render time. The split by angle essentially affects your line weight. 180 degrees means no line weight, and 90 to 100 degrees produce a heavier line weight value. But be careful with this, as a heavier line weight will often lead to unavoidable popping in the animated objects during render. So let's take everything we've just learned and apply it to our character. And we have a mess. Because we have rigs, curves, collections within collections, this creates a scene that we cannot manage or figure out for the line art tool. This method of line art generation relies completely on how you set up your scene collections. We actually now have to think about our work as a department, where each department in the pipeline will publish data, and each department will have their own scene setup requirements. In our lighting or line art department, we need all the front-end departments to filter into our scene into collections. Luckily, this is pretty easy. Let's delete Suzanne and link in our data, one object at a time. Go to File, Link, and navigate to the file where you want your object to link from, and then click into its object folder. Search for the object that you want to add to your scene and select Link. Place the new object into the LineArt targets collection. By linking the object instead of appending it, we are able to bring in the geometry without any of its linked items, collections, or rig data, making our line art or lighting scene super simple to work with and light. Linking in objects one at a time helps us troubleshoot issues and also make sure that the line art is looking good as we go. Keep in mind, when you link an object, you can't modify its information very easily. You'll have to make any adjustments to that object from the scene that you linked it from, or try to use overrides. As always, I've left a couple references for this in the description. Play with the line art thickness in conjunction with the parameters that we've already discussed. Let's bring in the hair next. With the sword, we see that the edges are way too thick. This is because the topology is very dense at the bevels. But since we like our line art settings for the rest of the scene, instead of adjusting everything, let's create a new collection and call it Line Art Thin. Then, duplicate the default line art object and rename this one Line Art Thin. Move the sword into the thin collection. Adjust the settings of both line art objects until you're happy with the overall look. For the thin collection, I reduced the max line thickness and made sure the flatten to camera space was checked off for both line art objects, which is typically my default setting. This way, the line art won't render on top of our scene objects. Looking good. Keep linking in your objects, and before you know it, this is our 2D scene so far. So in 2D, on twos, the cloth is looking great, but everything feels super static and lifeless. We'll need to add some subtle motion just to bring it all together. For this, I'm going to use two main methods: live animation and noise animation, like we did for the wind in the previous episode. To understand more about live animation, check out this video and channel. They're super talented. Starting with the hair, select the object and go into edit mode. Grab the end control points. I like to select every other hair or randomly placed hairs so that when I add motion, it doesn't feel too uniform. Now hit Control H. Select Hook to New Object. This creates an empty that will control these curve points which we can animate. Continue to create hooks for all the hair points. Have your timeline start at minus 50 so that you have some run-up time before you can record your animation. Now, with auto key on, with the object you want to animate selected, hit the play button on your timeline. Use the shortcut on your keyboard for the move or rotate tools and basically just move what you want to animate in real time, and Blender will record everything you do. Now just puppeteer the controls in real time to give the hair a motion like it's moving in the air. This makes animation super intuitive and hyper fast. And if you don't like a take, simply delete the keyframes and re-record again, like a live set. Great, let's do the same for the necklace. You can grab all the empties and here, under Data, hold the Alt key, then click on the size value and scale them all down at the same time. For the bull head, same principle. I'm just going to record its rotation directly. Okay, let's add some rotation animation on the sword. For the shoelaces, we can apply hooks like we did for the hair to the lace guide curves. Since our eyes aren't focusing on the shoes in our scene, we can just use noise modifiers like we did in the previous episode to generate a sense of them blowing in the wind. Add noise modifiers one axis at a time to see what looks best visually, and play with adding it both on the location and rotation channels. Click on the rig and apply noise at the root. And then in pose mode, select the bones that you want affected by the wind and add modifiers to them as well. This is looking good so far. Let's see how it looks like in 2D again. Great. But the body is still static. Let's create a quick shape key rig. Under Object Data, create a base shape and another one called Right Arm with a value of 1. Looks like we've lost our face set somewhere along the process. But no worries. Just go to Edit Mode, select the faces you want for a body part, then add them to a vertex group. Name them, and with them still selected, go to Sculpt Mode. Click on Face Sets from Edit Mode Selection. Repeat the process for all your limbs that you want to rotate. Awesome. Now in Sculpt Mode, we can use the Pose Tool. Then under the Pose Tool Options, Rotation Origins, select Face Sets FK. Now just rotate the arm as you want it. This method of animating will work, but large motions or complex arcs aren't advisable, as it will lead to weird shapes and errors. This is more of a cheat workaround to a proper rig. Cool. Now I'm creating an empty from the camera view and applying all the transformations to deltas so that the location and rotation is set to 0. On the right arm shape key, right click and select Set a Driver. Add the empty that we just created to the object options. You can then add the value at the bottom of the driver dialog to the expressions value so that there isn't an offset between 0 of the X axis on the empty and the shape key value. The empty's X axis now drives or controls the arm's shape key. Live animate the empty like we did earlier until you're happy with the arm animation. Repeat the process as much as you want. For example, I'm creating another shape key for the breath control by using the grab and inflate tools to expand the chest and stomach areas. This is a great and quick way to add some life to a sculpt if you're not intending to rig a full character. Here's the final setup. I have shape drivers for the breathing, shoulder twisting, chest twisting, laughing, head bopping, and jaw expanding, as well as right arm and left arm movement. And this is the final result in CG. And this is our 2D render. Looking good. Even though we're cheating the motion, it's just enough motion so that the shot doesn't feel totally lifeless like before. Let's add some detailed line art on the geometry to give it a more natural feeling. Combining hand-drawn and CG elements is the key to immersion, and balancing the two is always the goal. We'll talk about texturing more in detail when we get into the production series, but briefly, the body UVs are set up on 3 UDIM tiles. Under Texture Paint Mode in the Paint window, go to Image, New. Select your desired resolution, I'm working in 4K, and use a white background color. And finally, click Tiled. On the right-hand side in the Image menu, under UDIM Tiles, click on the plus button twice, until all your UVs are on a background. Now that we set up the UDIM tiles, save the images. This creates 3 texture images that is used on your body UVs. We can set up a material to read these, or in the texture slots, you can select single image mode. Select the 3 images that we created and hit open image. Paint anywhere on the body and the texture works. I'm going to adjust the stroke settings to get a more inky brush. Go to orthographic mode and start painting the line art you want. Increasing the subdivisions on the body will get you smoother paint strokes. Paint in line art where you feel lines would be present from any angle. don't go overboard with this, we just want to add some artistic flair. Create a new emission material. Then in the shader menu, hit Shift A and search for image texture. Now open the three images that we created in the texture paint mode. Link the file output color to the emission input color. The emission shader now has our textures. Here's the final result. I only textured from the camera angle and added lines I knew would work for the shot. I added some detail work for the Air Toro ones, some branding for the trousers, runes on the sword and the ribbon. Okay, time to render. So we're cutting off the ribbon in our camera view. So in render settings, I'm going to add an overscan. We'll discuss overscan a bit more in the rendering video, but basically it's a percent of the frame we render outside of our final framing that allows us to reposition our frame in comp if we want. In this case, I really don't want to adjust the camera at this point, so I'm just going to add a 150% overscan that renders the full scene. Next, under frame range, I set my step to 2. Which means we'll be watching the animation on 2s. And therefore, I have my first frame set to 2 as well, as I don't want frame 0 or frame 1. Choose a directory that you want to render in, and use a name ending in hashtags. This is to set your frame buffers. For example, test_lineart01_####. This way you'll have a frame buffer of 4. Meaning frame 1 will be 0001. Turn on your LineArt modifier geometry nodes and hit Ctrl F12 to render the full frame range. And there we go. We have our LineArt. With that, next week, let's finish this off by animating the face with Blender's Grease Pencil. And then we're only 2 more videos to wrap this series. As always, if you'd like to follow us on our journey of making our own anime, hit the like, subscribe, and alert buttons, even comment. Feel free to follow us on our other socials, and I'll see you next time. Thank you for watching!